friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. So many times his description says it was like such and such, but it wasn't exactly that. It was just too glorious to put into words. So I'm looking forward to seeing what heaven looks like. Can't imagine what it'd be like to stand next to the pearly gates or next to the walls that are made of precious stones. I really can't even begin to imagine what it is to walk into the presence of God and see the very sights. Not a wonderful future. How about another song?
They have any pets there?
The Bible doesn't say that there are pets, but it does talk about in the book of Revelation, the horses, you know, that come, the four horses.
Did Jesus ride a horse?
A donkey. It was actually a donkey's foal, the foal of a donkey that nobody had ever ridden on before. Because in those days, royalty, we oftentimes think about white stallions. Well, the military leaders might ride around on a white stallion, but the rulers oftentimes rode on donkeys. So, how about another song? 39.
39.
Great is thy faithfulness. Be thinking about, as we sing the song, something that you would like to share about the faithfulness of God, of what God has done for you.
Mm-hmm.
Donna Schoolcraft, that was back with us this morning, and she was giving thanks to God's faithfulness, providing for her needs. There were many things when she got out of hospital she was going to need, and she said, people gave it, but she says, I know that the Lord was behind the giving, because she said, I needed a shower chair, I needed a potty chair, I needed a scooter, a knee scooter. She needed a ramp for the front of her house. She said, I'm thinking to myself there in the hospital, going to be a lot of financial output. She said, what do you know? God not only provided that, but even gave us food. Said people brought food for them to eat so that she didn't have to eat Cheryl's cookie. So great is God's faithfulness. Does anybody have a word of testimony of the faithfulness of God, the way that God has supplied?
Well, I know you. There's no doubt why I'm here. If it would have been for him, all the prayers that have been answered, I'm a second.
He's not done with her.
That's right. And you're not done with her either. No. We thank the Lord that he spared you, Mrs. W. You're a blessing. You are dearly loved by her.
People ask me, well, how did you make it through that? I said, the Lord. I said, that's the only answer I can give. That and the prayers. They go, you really believe that? And I said, I have always believed in prayers, but I truly believe.
Amen. I think about when she was over there at the care facility in Wintersville, Sienna Woods. And she had a little room there, kind of the end of the hallway. And I guess her daughter-in-law brought her a little bird feeder that she was able to mount outside the window on the window itself. And she would just lay there every day. And all that she could do is just lay there and watch that bird to come and eat. And at that point, we didn't know that she would ever be able to get out of the care facility. But little by little, the Lord has continued to strengthen her. And so as I said here a few minutes ago, this is the first time she's been able to be to two church services in the same day. She was here this morning and back again tonight. And we say, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
I thank him every day.
Amen.
For taking care of life
and life. Amen.
He did.
Amen. Yeah. Other testimonies of the faithfulness of God. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Tell them the date you're going to send him home. Tell them the date.
July 1st?
1st of July, yeah, that week.
Yeah, he's going to be up there through the remainder of June for therapy, but to God be the glory. That is tremendous that he's able to move that foot. And you told us this morning he's starting to get more and more feeling back there, which is good. When I went up to see him a little over a week ago, about a week and a half ago, he told me that he had no feeling from the navel down. So now he's starting to get some feeling back, which is, once again, great is thy faithfulness. Any other testimonies of God's faithfulness?
If you don't believe in miracles, there's two of us sitting right here that are miracles.
Amen. Amen. Well, another song then. Yes, you do.
You know, I thank the Lord about this so many times, that the people that he put in my life to encourage me, to lift me up, and to edify me. When I think back, before I was even a Christian, the people that he put in my life that encouraged me to go to church and to come to know the Lord as my personal Savior. And he's still doing it.
You've been an encouragement to us, to me personally.
But you know, God works that way.
Yes.
Through people, to encourage us and to lift us up. We're doing that today, right now. We got an object of men's prayer breakfast.
That's right. Oh, and I forgot to mention earlier this morning for the men, this Friday. Isn't it Friday or Saturday?
Friday.
Friday.
Isn't it
out of the Nazarene Church on Washington Pike. They're having their annual fish fry out there, and I forgot to mention that this morning. So that's this Friday at 6 o'clock, isn't it?
I think that's what you said.
Yeah, I don't have my pocket calendar with me.
It's 6 o'clock.
6 o'clock. So that's when you go out of Wellsburg and you go up to the top of the first big hill, there's a church on the left, sits back there. That's the Nazarene Church, and it's for the men.
Wow, if I show up, don't kick me out.
Is Johnny Keener the preacher out there?
I don't know if John Keener.
He's associate.
He's associate.
Okay, I thought he was there.
But we've grown to know a lot of the guys out there, wonderful brothers in the Lord.
Yeah.
And I'm sure if a woman showed up, they're not gonna.
Yeah, I like fish, so I might just show up.
And I don't know how many people would you say was there last year, at least 75. You think 100? But anyhow, they don't take up any money. Rodney, who organized the whole thing, he doesn't want any donations. People come and try to slip him. He says, no, I'm not. That's what he said in the past. He says, we want to do this as a ministry, just to give people an opportunity, brothers in Christ and sisters, to come and be encouraged. To let you know that there are others in the community that share faith. And it's a really, really nice event. And food is good for those of you that like seafood. Good stuff. So, we agree with you, Joe. Thank the Lord for those people that the Lord brings into our lives to encourage us. We do need encouragement these days. How about one more song? You have one more song? Or any other testimonies? His goodness and his grace reached out to all of us. It wasn't us reaching out to him, it was him reaching out to us.
Yeah, you know, I was being blessed here and there, and I thought, boy, it all struck luck.
No,
it struck luck.
No. By divine appointment.
Jacksonville, he says, come down, we're going to make a mold of you, had to get off the plane. And my sister's girlfriend's a nurse. She was wide-eyed, and she says, this stuff just don't happen.
Amen.
And whenever they started on me, I got a call from them. They said, don't you worry about anything. We'll take care of everything. I get a call. They said Medicare is refusing. They said, but we're going to go anyway. Cancer don't wait. And they said, but we know them. He says, they'll come across. And they did. We didn't wait.
God be the glory.
Yeah, my sister said, there's more to this than you realize.
Amen. In all the events of our lives, there's more to it than what we realize. The Lord is at work. To God be the glory. Great is his faithfulness. 534. 534. Some golden daybreak. forward to the return of the Lord Jesus Christ. Pray that you've had a great afternoon. Good to have you in the Lord's house tonight. Good to have a little larger turnout tonight. Good to have some people back with us that have been here a while. Thank you for coming out to the Lord's house. Our Lord is worthy of our worship. Appreciate you being here. We've already kind of been over announcements, I think. And we'll have prayer time. Got a couple of kind of prayer requests that need to mention. Chuck and Bessie said that their great-grandson, little Beckett, he's been on our prayer list how many times now? Broke two fingers on his hand and he cut his arm really bad, and they were waiting on an ambulance.
Surgeon.
In Pittsburgh?
Yeah, we don't know which hospital.
So Keith, little Beckett, puts in prayer.
What he got in his backyard? He wasn't even racing.
A dangerous place to be.
It is. Pray for his parents. You know, I'm sure they're kind of like, Beckett, come on, buddy. Help us out here a little bit. Yeah. And I also got a call right before church started from Jane Cook. I mentioned her this morning. She is now at Unity Apartments in Wellsburg, room 104. They released her on Friday, and that's where she is right now. I know that they were supposedly working on her house to do some upgrades on the house. But if you get a chance, if you need her cell phone number, let me know. I can give you her cell phone number. And, but just continue to keep her in prayer. What other ones do we need to mention? Joe?
We have a couple of prayers.
Okay.
My wife was in church today for the first time in 5 months.
Wow. To God be the glory.
Amen.
First time in 5 months his wife was in church. She was able to go to church.
And then laid up in the Lord.
But, yesterday, I spent the day at Man Up program in Pittsburgh with Pastor and Orion and Chuck Kellum.
Mm-hmm.
And if you've never experienced 1,000 men praising and worshiping the Lord,
Joe's been going out for how many years?
Oh,
it's one of the large churches there in Pittsburgh.
Yeah, Victory Church. I guess it would be Evans City would be the address there, but it's not right in town. But,
and every year they will have, you know, some high-profile speakers.
Oh, yeah.
And even
Ben Roethlisberger was the guest speaker there yesterday. Also, Mike Tomlin was there, and Highsmith, I can't think of his first name, he was there. You know, very interesting. But they are a mission that reaches out to the North Hills of Pittsburgh. And the results they've had over the years in that community, they specifically try to reach children that are in single-parent homes. Marvelous job. If you hear the numbers and the statistics and the change that they've made in that community, is amazing. Just, you know.
So you'll have to keep us posted next year, but you may want to put that on your bucket list to go to one of these. If you've never been into a large gathering, especially if it's, you know, just a men or even the women's conferences, a lot of times the women will do conferences, to get there with people, you know, same gender as you, and to hear all these people praise the Lord, it is something special. Joe, glad that you had a chance to go and be a part of that. It will inspire you.
Yeah.
Very inspirational. So, we rejoice with you. Praise the Lord that Penny's doing better, and grateful that you had a chance to go to this event. May the Lord bear fruit from it. Absolutely. Any other praises? You have an update on your dad there, Dan?
He's doing all right.
Okay, his shoulder healed up?
Yeah, it's healing up.
Okay. Anybody else?
Herb Summers can be taken off the prayer list. He's doing well.
Okay.
Back at work. And praise the Lord for that. He's had some heart issues before and they did surgery for that AFib, and he's getting along all right.
Did she ever say anything about his brother, Jeff?
No, I haven't heard anything. I guess he's back in the pulpit, I don't know.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Lord. Any others? No? Well, let's pray together. Father, we do rejoice for the answers to prayer. We rejoice with Joe, could hear the emotion in his voice, to have his wife be able to go back to church with him. Thank you, Lord, for what you've done, also for the experience he had with the men's fellowship. And pray, Father, that you will bear fruit from that gathering, and that we might be the light that we're called to be. May you, Father, inspire these men as they go back to your homes, to not only within their community, but within their homes, to be spokesmen for you. It's good to have here with our group tonight, both Janet. It's good to have her back. We thank you, Lord, for the way that you spared her. Of course, having Clyde with her. Again, we've already said with my dad, I'm so grateful for what you've done. And it's good to have Kathy with us tonight. I know that a week ago at this time, she was maybe on her way to the hospital. But Father, we're grateful that she's out of the hospital, and just pray that you'll continue to meet her needs. Grateful that Ralph is making progress on the ninth floor. Grateful that Jane Cook was able to get out of the hospital. Grateful that Herb Summers is able to take off our prayer list. Father, there are just so many on our prayer list, and we want to say thank you. I know that Janet had shared in her testimony that she's always believed in prayer, but what she has been through, and to see the way that you've answered prayers, just even made her all that more committed to praying. And Father, so we want to say thank you for hearing our prayer requests. We do pray that you would meet the needs of these others. We're concerned about little Beckett. We pray that his arm is going to be okay. And we pray, Father, that you'd help to protect him. Pray that you give him wisdom. It seems like he's had an awful lot of accidents for somebody his age. And we just pray that you'll continue to spare his life and help him to be able to not have as many accidents. But there are a lot of needs that we've got listed in our bulletin, and we come tonight and we ask that you might meet all of the needs. Many of the needs we've got listed are physical needs. Father, we should ask you, because we recognize from Scripture that Jesus went about healing people. You are concerned about physical needs, but we pray that you might give us a concern for spiritual needs. We pray, Father, I know in our Sunday school class this morning we talked about the Holy Spirit empowering those disciples there in Jerusalem to speak to others about Jesus. And we pray that you might do the same for us, that your Spirit might move in our hearts and our lives and give us the courage to speak to people and to tell them that they really need Jesus. That's what our world needs more than anything. So we do pray for the physical needs, but we also pray for the spiritual needs. And we pray, Father, for family members and loved ones, neighbors, co-workers, people around us, that they will come to know you. Please, Father, through your Spirit, speak to their hearts and draw them to you. We do pray, Father, that you'll even meet the unspoken needs. Every person here has, I'm sure, things that they're concerned about and they need your help. They don't talk about them with others, and we pray that you might meet those needs. We do pray for revival, that, Father, you'll revive not only our church, but churches everywhere. And we pray, Father, too, that you will continue to give us leaders that will have a heart for you. Father, it's very concerning to see decisions that have been made that are not honoring. And we pray that you might place it upon the leaders, of the hearts of leaders, that they will want those things that are good and pleasing in your sight. We do pray, Father, that you'll be with our military and law enforcement. Thank you for what they do for us. Please keep them safe. And as we have a chance to study your word tonight, we ask that you might open our hearts to hear what you're saying to us. May we grow in our understanding of the people that you've called us to be. Please continue to meet our needs. God, is that all you say and do that will honor you, forgive us when we fail you, and use us to be a blessing. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. We have for a couple weeks now talked about spiritual act of worship. If you look in 1 Peter chapter 2, this is the verse passage of Scripture. It's in the fifth verse. Peter writes to the Christians that are scattered. He talks about it over in the first verse, scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. He's writing to a group of Christians that are scattered all over the place. And in the fifth verse, he tells these Christians that you, like living stones, are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, and probably for a couple months we talked about the need for holiness within our lives. Holiness means to be set apart. We talk about this being a holy Bible. And because it's a holy book, we've been taught you need to treat it differently. And the same is true within our lives. We don't need to be just like everybody else. We have been called to be set apart. That's what was behind all of the regulations back in the book of Leviticus. When the children of Israel came out of Egypt and they were on their way to the promised land, God said to them, look, I want you to be different from all of these other nations that were there. And that's why he gave them all the regulations in the book of Leviticus. It was so that these people could, they were supposed to eat differently. They weren't supposed to eat the foods like everyone else. They were supposed to keep a Sabbath day holy. A lot of people in the rest of the world, they didn't do that. Sadly, within our culture, there was a time that we honored the Lord's Day more. People have kind of, as evidenced by not just the attendance here at this church, but across the United States, people are not really setting aside a day to rest and to worship. And God said, look, I want you to be different from the rest of the world. The rest of the world continues to go downhill. Their decision makings are all, it's all self-centered. It's whatever I feel like doing. God says, that is not going to make you happy. All that that's going to do is make things worse for you. When you just live to satisfy your desires, all that's going to do is just bring you down further. I know that I use illustrations like this all the time, but what if you ate only the stuff that you like the taste of? Do we have anybody, I think Clyde is one of these people, like sweets?
Like salt.
Salt. I was thinking that you told me one time, Clyde, that you really like the desserts. No? Yeah, a little bit. Well, as kids, we were growing up, we liked the sweets. What happens if that's all that you eat?
You get diabetes.
You get diabetes. You get overweight, develop all sorts of physical problems.
You look like me.
In all sincerity, though, I use that as an illustration, saying this is what happens when you do only what you want to do. God sent Jesus into the world not just to forgive us of our sins, but to teach us, look, don't start obeying, you know, your earthly appetites, what you feel like doing, because those are what have created the problems for you. I've said it before, you and I are our own worst enemies. We're the ones that make these decisions. So he had talked about, I want you to be a holy people, and I still believe that you and I need to focus more upon being different from the rest of the world, not for being different's sake, but because the differences that God wants for us are things that are going to be helpful to us in the long run. I was on the phone before I came to church tonight talking with Charlie and Diane Porter. I talked with Miss Bessie, and then I called Charlie and Diane and was talking with them. And I talked about the fact that our church is like a lot of churches made up primarily of older people. And I said, I'm grateful that I have the church to go to. We talked about in particular the fact that years ago, 40 years ago, when I was a teenager, the church played more of a central role in people's lives. Charlie even talked about that at the church that he was at, he was kind of a youth leader at the church at the time. They did, you know, they'd go bowling, they'd go skating, they used to go, what was the other thing that he ended up talking about? Hay rides out there in the country. There used to be like a lot of social activities that the church was involved in. I told him that when I was growing up, when I was in high school, our church had a softball team. Now let me just ask you a question. How many churches around have softball teams? And back in those days, almost every church did.
We used to have one here.
But I'm saying it was more than just here. There was all churches basically had it.
Oh yeah, we had church teams.
What's happened? How many churches have them now?
I played softball in Florida for weeks and weeks. And they were regulated teams. You did not argue, you did not swear, did not do anything that was wrong.
And they say, when I first came here, we had here at the church, bowling. We haven't had a bowling team, anything like that. And I'm not saying that those are necessarily spiritual activities, but what I'm saying is that the church played more of a central role in people's lives. What I talked with Charlie and Diane about was that right now, all that our church is basically offering is tomorrow. What's tomorrow? Game day. Oh, we're going to have a dinner a week from this coming Sunday on the 23rd. We do a dinner here at the church. We just decided to do that this year. Every 2 months, we're going to do a dinner. But apart from the game day tomorrow and our regularly scheduled services, nothing's going on. And it's not just this church. It's just about...
Just like Bible school. Same thing.
And by the way, I was really encouraged this morning. My buddy Jefferson Davis, he's the... Or Jefferson Ellis, not Jefferson Davis. He's a pastor over in Hanover, Pennsylvania, at Presbyterian Church. He sent me a text message that their church every year does a vacation Bible school. He said, we've already got enrolled for our vacation Bible school. It's going to be this week. We've already pre-enrolled 83 kids. Sherry, I know, used to help with vacation Bible school down at Riverview. How many of y'all used to have at Riverview?
There was times we have, what, 100 and some.
Yes, believe me, I used to have like 20 just in the nursery.
Yes.
Because I always did nursery.
Yeah, 1 year we had 35 to 50 1 year in the nursery. Yes.
That was the year that we had.
I was like ready to pull my hair out.
35 to 50 in the nursery?
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
We had no shoes.
It didn't seem like you had enough people in there to help. Because every time you turn around, you was changing a diaper, fixing a bottle. You were doing something, trying to keep this from getting into that.
I was going to see if you could wrangle somebody out of the teen class to come and help.
Yeah.
And they didn't want to come, and they said, we need you.
And what's happened? I'll tell you what's happened. In short, back to this passage of Scripture. The church has become like the world.
Too relaxed.
We have followed the world.
Too relaxed. We got too...
Too relaxed. God has been pushed out of our lives, mm-hmm. and we've embraced more of the things of the world. And God is saying, through Peter, who's writing these Christians, look, I want you to be holy, I want you to be separate. And quite honestly, and this isn't a cry on your shoulders, but one of the things I've talked with Charlie and Diane about, and I talked the other night with Sheila about this, is that unless things change, what's going to be the story of Calvary Baptist Church 5 years from now? This morning, Joe, you should have been here this morning, we had in our sanctuary, in the center aisle, 3 people sitting in wheelchairs. Nothing against the wheelchair community, but these are, well, Bonnie, of course, she's recovering, she's not allowed to put any weight. But you got Ron Taylor, in his 80s now, and Bucky, in the month of August, is going to be 90. And that's not to count the number of people within our church with canes and the number of people that come with walkers. And what I ended up saying to Charlie and Diane, it's a concern. Why? Because it's not just the story of this church, it's the story of so many churches. 5 years from now, how many of those people are still going to be around to go to church? And when they're not here, who's going to fill the place? And so Peter is saying to these Christians, look, you need to be separate from the world. And quite honestly, this is a plea on my part, that people might place more of an emphasis upon the work of the church. If you just stop and think about the way that the church has gone downhill in the past 40 years, what is going on with people, church has become less and less of a priority. Miss Bessie, I talked with her some about it too, and she said the church kind of used to be the social gathering. This is where people came to connect with each other. Now people are mostly connecting.
And I said, smartphones. When they started with their phones, I said to my husband and a couple of my friends, people were going to make fun of me, but them things for the mark of the beast. I don't care what anybody says. Because you stop and think about growing up. Yeah, there were pedophiles, but they didn't know where you lived or who you were or anything. No, they know too much anymore.
And now kids don't want to be in church.
No, and
they want to be on that phone, or they want to be in front of the game system. You say, let's go to church. You want me to do what for a couple hours? No, I don't think so. I want to do this.
And again, this ties back in that Peter is saying, look, I want you to be different from society. And part of what I'm making the case for, we're different from society, because the rest of the society sees no use for the church. And sadly, I'm going to take one more step here. Not only does society not see much use for the church, many people within the church don't see a need for the church. And I want you to think about one more thing. As the church has continued to lose its status within the community, and the church has continued to decline, what has gone on with society around us? Society has continued. Folks, we need to make more of an emphasis upon us coming together, studying the Word of God, and emphasizing those things that God is interested in. So Peter is saying to these people, you need to be separate from the rest of the world. Don't mimic the rest of the world. The rest of the world says, you don't need church. You don't need that much church. You can just let church go. You can worship God anywhere. And I'm just telling you, that's the world's way. God says, I want you to be different from that. I want you folks, now I've used the illustration before, you are to be a thermostat, not a thermometer. A thermostat, I walk over here to the thermostat, and if I press that thing up, it's going to either raise or lower the temperature. You control the environment. That's what the church is to do. Rather, the church has become a thermometer. Whatever the rest of society, the church just adjusts to be just like society. And so Peter has ended up saying, that's not God's plan. What God wants you to do is to work on being different, not for difference sake, but that difference is going to make a difference. I started to tell you that when I told Charlie and Diane, I stopped to wonder where my life would have gone had it not been for church in my life. If I had not been in church to keep me close to God, it would have been very easy to become like the rest of the world. But anyhow, I know my time's getting away. The second thing that we talked about from this verse, not only are we to be a holy priesthood, but we are to be offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. And I had you look at a passage of scripture. We're going to go back here again tonight. Romans chapter 12. He says you're to be offering spiritual sacrifices. People say, what is a spiritual sacrifice? Well, the Apostle Paul said in Romans chapter 12, verse 1, he said, therefore, I beseech you, brethren, in the King James Version, I beseech you, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. So he says your spiritual sacrifice is offering yourself to God. It's offering your entire self, your body, your mouth. There's a song we used to sing out of the Baptist hymnal. It's probably in other hymnals too. But I can't remember the exact title of it, but I offer to God my hands, I offer to God my tongue, I offer to God my lips, I offer to God every part of myself that God might use me for service to him. So there are specific things that he talks about that you and I can do to offer our bodies as a living sacrifice. And we started over in the ninth verse of Romans chapter 12. First thing that he said, and I don't want to spend much time on these because I want to get to new ones. Be sincere when you love people. Don't just kind of, yeah, I love you. Really genuinely care about the person. If you're saying it with your mouth that you love the person, but you don't mean it with your heart, which carries more weight? Your heart. It says make sure that your love is sincere. Second thing that he said, learn to hate what is evil. People say, well, I don't think that we're supposed to hate. the Bible says we're maybe not supposed to hate people, but we are supposed to hate evil. Sadly, what we find sometimes within our lives, rather than hating it, we play around with it. We think, it's not really all that bad. I used as an illustration this morning, maybe it's too familiar, but people that play around with alcohol. You say, well, you know, it's not a bad thing. I can drink, you know, an alcohol and I can control it. Janet's sitting there shaking her head.
But it's not good when it's a pregnant mother drinking and giving it to that baby, and that baby's born with the DTs and stuff.
And let me say, it's not good just, not with just pregnant women, but it's not good any time Janet's sitting there.
No, but I'm saying, and the baby pays the consequences.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Janet was sitting there shaking her head because she grew up.
Yeah, it's not good.
And she talked about having to go down to the bar, get her dad before. And she said to Clyde, when they got married, gave him a death threat.
Yeah, that's one thing I would walk out.
You ever shocked? Why am I? Because people oftentimes they will play around. They don't learn to hate what is evil. People say, it isn't evil. That stuff is not evil. Let me tell you what, there's statistics to say otherwise.
Yeah, Mommy always used to say it takes a bigger man to say no as a man opposed to having drugs.
Yeah.
And you can start on anything. How many people, I used the illustration this morning, took that first puff of a cigarette? Maybe it was to be cool, maybe it was to be like somebody else. And 40, 50 years later, they developed all sorts of health issues because every time you suck that smoke down in your lungs, it's damaging your lungs. And I've seen before on YouTube bodies of people that, you know, they're doing like an autopsy and they're showing you what the lungs of a person that has died that's been a smoker, lungs are absolutely black. Black.
But it's not only really that there's pain. I suffer from asthma, but I don't smoke. But my mother smoked to the day she died.
And that's
why I have the asthma.
And it does affect other people. And again, people say, well, you're beating the drum that Christians are all the time beating the same thing. No, I want to just use it as an illustration to say we need to learn to hate what is evil. This past November in Ohio, they passed a law about marijuana. What was the law that they passed?
It's legal.
What do you mean it's legal?
As long as Here's
the point I'm making. Recreational marijuana. We're not talking medicinal. And by the way, I don't have a problem with medicinal. Any medicine that you have is regulated. They say you need to watch it. It's only supposed to be administered by a doctor. So anything, painkillers, whatnot. And that's basically what the marijuana does. Medicinal works, I've got no problem with it. They passed it for recreational. You can take it just for the fun of it. You're playing around with something that's fire. The problem that we run into is that people end up saying, it's not really evil. I can play around with this and not get burned. And you find out.
It goes to something stronger, and that's not good enough. Let's go further and see what we can get and how we can get it.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And it carries over in everything that you and I give way to the things that we like. And those things, many times, we know what the Word of God says, you need to stay away from it, but we end up saying to God, I know that you're telling me to stay away from it, but I really don't think that it's all that bad. I'm going to go ahead and do it anyhow. And God says, okay, I want you to know this. You're going to reap the consequences of your decision. Okay? So, he said, your spiritual worship is when you learn to say about evil. The word I've told you before, confess, is actually a word that means to say the same thing about something that God says about it. It's when you come to the realization that God said that this is bad, that this is dangerous, that this is not good. When you finally come to to the point that you say, oh, I guess God was right. It's kind of like the kids that grow up thinking their parents don't know anything. Then they finally get out on their own and they start experiencing some of the same stuff their parents went through, and all of a sudden the parents' IQ more than doubles overnight. Mom and dad weren't as dumb. It's when you come to realization that God knows what he's talking about. And he says you need to learn to hate those things that are evil. Don't you sit around and try to rationalize it, because the Satan will have you look at everything and begin to question God. And that's exactly what happened to Adam and Eve in the garden. God had said very specifically, don't eat of that. And Satan came along and says, well, he didn't really mean that. You know, it is nice to look at, and I'm sure that it tastes good too. And really, the only reason he doesn't want you to have it is because he doesn't want you to become like it. Satan will use your desires against you. And we know from that story how it ended up. So he says, learn to hate those things that are evil, and learn to what? Cling to those things that are good. I hate to go back and beat on this drum one more time. But was being in church good when we used to have all that stuff? How many of you would say, I miss those days when we used to play softball? I miss those times when we used to have, you know, bowling. I miss those times when we used to have the kids' events. April grew up in this church.
Weenie roast. We used to have weenie roast.
Weenie roast?
Bring them down and watch a movie and roast hot dogs and marshmallows and just have the evening.
Well, we take them up to Cuddle and Jim's and
let
them. Yeah. When I first came here, I know that my brother had us out there at his house in the fall, and we would do a hayride.
Yeah.
In the fall. I remember a couple of different times, if I'm not mistaken, we went out to Faith Ranch. Was anybody here in the church that went out to Faith Ranch with us? And we went horseback riding. I'm just talking about things that there used to be all sorts of activities. What happened?
We even had overnighters at the church.
We had overnighters here at the church. We got pictures of what happened. This is the question. What happened? And I'll tell you what happened. We didn't hold on to those things. Church wasn't viewed as an imposition back then. Church was viewed as something that was necessary. And we made it more of an integral part of our lives. And this isn't a poor me situation. I expressed my frustration to Miss Bessie, and I expressed it to Charlie and Diane. I get the feeling that everybody wants to have a great church. Everybody would like to have Calvary Baptist Church and parking lot filled, and let's have all sorts of activities and so on and so forth. But there's no way to do that with people saying, I'll be at church 1 hour a week. I'm sorry, I can't do anything. If we don't, and again, it goes back to cling to what is good. I personally am grateful that I grew up in an era that the church was offering more things. And it wasn't just this church. Church was everywhere. What happened? The people didn't exercise their spiritual worship clinging to what is good. Sometimes I use the word clinging, cellophane. You know, those cellophane wrapper that your saltine cracker gets in? And you tear that wrapper off and you get the cracker out, but the cellophane sticks to your hand. And you flip it like that and you can't get the thing. You know what I'm talking about? And that's what Paul says in the book of Romans. One of the things that you can do as a spiritual act of worship to God is to hold on to those things that are good. I want to spend more time because we've just scratched the surface. This whole chapter is talking about these acts of spiritual worship. Look at some of the other things that he talks about in the 11th verse. And we talked about this last week. Never be lacking in zeal. Because I used the story of Phineas from the Old Testament, that Phineas, there was a Midianite woman that was brought into the camp of Israel. And Phineas was one of the priests. And he saw that this man, this Israelite, had brought this Midianite woman that was, you know, an ungodly woman, had brought her into the camp, right in the presence of everybody. And Phineas was zealous for the Lord. And I'm not encouraging people to do this. But he went into the tent where this man and woman were engaged in, you know, and he took a spear and he drove it through both of them. So he went through the man and into the woman, killed both of them on the spot. Because God was very upset with what's going on. There were like, I forget how many tens of thousands of people there in Israel that got killed because of their infidelity of what they've been doing. And because Phinehas did this, the Lord stopped his judgment and many thousands of lives were saved. But I use that illustration that Phinehas was zealous for the Lord. He fought to hold on to those things that were right in God's sight. And he wasn't afraid to stand up for those things that God was pleased with. And there are other things that he says in the 12th chapter. Pray. Always keep on praying. There's so many things that you and I, sometimes we can let go of those things that are good within our lives, whether it's Bible reading or prayer or whatnot. And he says, don't do that because this is your spiritual worship. When you keep doing those things that are right in God's eye, God is pleased. When you give up doing those things, you're becoming like everybody else and God is not pleased. So anyhow, we'll come back to Romans chapter 12. But this is what spiritual worship is all about. It is allowing God to use us to honor him and to point other people to him. We don't need more people to tell us how the society operates.
There's no society because of talking to people. My son, he's an example too, because I did the dominoes, dice, cards, you know, play games then. Oh, I'm not going to play that. What's there, you know, maybe a one-on-one? No. I'm going to stare at a computer screen and play games to myself. So we're not communicating with each other anymore.
And again, the way that we live, that is our spiritual act of worship. That is the way we can please God or displease
what
God.
What your best pleasure is, that's your God. Your pleasure is there, that's where you're at.
Amen.
I remember when I was a small child, maybe 8 or 9, and this old man, his name was Mr. Casto, he said, I is our biggest problem. I am my biggest problem. Mm-hmm. 50 years ago, in Kings Creek Community Church, I heard an old man say, I is our biggest problem, and you just said it.
Somebody said before, my dad may have even used it as a sermon illustration, the word sin, S-I-N, at the heart of that word, the middle letter is I.
And it's always been true. I mean, I've heard 3 different people say it, like I was 50 years apart.
Yes.
It's always been true.
And again, the Christian life is learning to not focus upon I, it's to focus upon God. And what God wants. We didn't get a chance to get it tonight, but as I was reading through that chapter before I came here to church tonight, 4 different times in those last verses of that 12th chapter, and read it for yourself, he says, don't try to seek revenge. Don't try to plan getting back at somebody. He says, you need to learn to do good. Four different times. He's like, do you have to repeat that four times? He says it in a different way each time, but it's something that you and I need to be reminded about, because when we're out there on the highway and somebody does something to us, well, our initial reaction is, I'm going to get back. And four times, I feel like that he's emphasizing this because it's one of the strongest emotions that we have, is to always try to get back at somebody. He says, don't do that. 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 So anyhow, we'll have more time talking about Romans chapter 12. I appreciate you being here tonight. And if you're able to make it on Wednesday night, we'd love to have you on Wednesday night too. Try to make church, and I know y'all are here, so preach in the choir. Try to make church, not just here, but every church, more central in your life. Because I believe that you will see tremendous differences in your personal life, and we will see a bigger change in society. So, let's have a closing prayer. Father, I pray that you might help us as we prayerfully will seek for revival. That, Father, we need to be revived. I think that everybody here can think back to years ago, and they know that what I'm saying is true. The churches were much more active, and our society was less dysfunctional. And I just pray, Father, that you'll help us to recognize those things that have kind of pulled us away. And probably it's been unholiness. Things that rather than us being separate from the rest of the world, we could just become more like the world. It maybe isn't, we've kind of said like the world, well, it's not necessary to go to church. It's not necessary to go to Sunday school. It's not necessary to really spend any time in prayer. And whether we've been aware of it or not, slowly we've drifted away from you. And it's evident. All a person has to do is just look at the attendance records of a church. And I pray that there can be a great turning back to you. The Father, would be wonderful. Once again, not only see here at Calvary Baptist Church, look out this window and see a parking lot filled with people. And then during the course of the week to have various activities, because serving you and honoring you is more important than other things. So we just pray that you might help us to really take to heart what Paul is writing, that we might once again offer you ourselves. You gave us everything when you offered us your Son, Jesus Christ. Help us to be willing to offer you ourselves in service. Dismiss us with your blessing. Bring us back the next appointed time. And until then, use us for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you.